lives become our kids in some way or another. So as I was praying about what the Lord wanted to say this morning, the Lord talks to us in just very simple ways sometimes. So I had a Belveeta biscuit cookie thing breakfast bar for the first time, and I went, this is good. I wasn't expecting it. It was just like dry cracker thing. I was like, wow, yes, exactly what he said to me. And I went, wow, like it surprised me. And the Lord said, yes, taste and see that I am good. And I thought, well, you know what's funny is I may have been, you know, doing other things. I like to multitask and do five things at once. And so I just stopped and I ate my little biscuit and I tasted. And I thought, you know, sometimes those little tiny things are what the Lord wants us to remember that bring us such joy. Because we get so busy, we don't always remember to take the time to taste and see that God is good.
Amen.
So I'm going to read to us this morning from Psalm 34. I'm going to read from the Message Bible, so it's a little different translation than maybe we're used to. I bless God every chance I get. My lungs expand with his praise. I live and breathe God. If things aren't going well, hear this and be happy. Join me in spreading the news. Together, let's get the word out. God met me more than halfway. He freed me from my anxious fears. Look at him. Give him your warmest smile. Never hide your feelings from him. When I was desperate, I called out, and God got me out of a tight spot. God's angels set up a circle of protection around us while we pray. Open your mouth and taste. Open your eyes and see how good God is. Blessed are you who run to him. Worship God if you want the best. Worship open doors to all his goodness. Very simple. We've all read Psalm 34 before, but a couple things jumped out to me. Open your mouth and taste. How many of you have ever fed a baby who tried something for the first time and watched them light up as they went, that's good. They wiggle their toes, their little fingers. God wants us to taste his goodness. He wants us to taste, open our mouths and taste everything he's blessed us with and get excited about it and enjoy it. Those little babies, they just are so overwhelmed with their feelings of pleasure and joy and thank you. And they open their little mouths, feed me more, more, more. God says, ask me for more. If I'm blessing you and you love it and you appreciate it, ask me for more. It's his pleasure. It is his pleasure to give us blessings and to give us the good things he gives us. Ever watched fancy wine snobs drink the best, most expensive, ridiculously priced bottles of wine? They sniff it, they swirl it, they put a little bit in there, they swish it. They use all the parts of their tongue, because all the different parts of our tongue have different taste sensors, right? Some are sour, some are sweet. And they gurgle it, and then they drink it down. Or they spit it out. But they're using every ounce of what they have to experience the wine. Why don't we take the time to experience all of the blessings God has for us? Why don't we take the time to smell the bouquet? It's spring. It's my favorite time of year. The world is coming back to life. He created everything beautiful all around us for our pleasure. Lilacs and daffodils are my favorite springtime blessings. Just the fragrance, walking through the flower centers and sniffing and dreaming of beautiful flowers to come and beautiful blossoms. And the other thing that the Lord told me is you have to focus to receive the blessings. How many times we just chow down food, going on to the next thing, or sit in front of the TV and not even thinking about what we're eating, or doing something else and just chowing down food and not taking the time to really to smell it, to enjoy it. How many times we go through life and just go blow through and not even think about, you know, I got the best parking spot today. You know, that one thing I needed at the store was on sale and they had one just for me on clearance. All the little blessings that God does to provide for us in every way. Oh, it happened to, you know, car breakdown. Oh, yep, that's under warranty. Let me just give you a new one. I mean, the blessings. God is with us every step of the way. He's one step ahead of us. But if we don't focus, if we're not looking for the blessings, if we're not focused on the blessings, if we're worried about the problem and focused on the problem, all we're gonna see, all we're gonna feel is the stress and anxiety of those situations and those problems. But if we look for the blessings, We experience the joy of realizing all of the little blessings that keep us in a good place. Amen. And the other little thing that I noticed, open your mouth and taste. I just have to open my mouth. God feeds me. Mm-hmm. Just like that little baby. Right. I don't have to prepare the meal. I don't have to go grocery shopping for it. I don't have to chop it up. I don't have to wash it. I don't have to cook it. I don't have to clean up the pots and pans afterwards. Can I get an amen, moms? Yeah. I just open my mouth and I taste.
Yeah.
Open my mouth and receive and taste. We need to ask God. We need to ask God and we need to thank him. I always think of the king reclined with a feather. Feeding him the grapes. We are kings and priests. Now, I'm not going to ask my husband to feed me grapes when I get home today. I don't think that would fly. But the Lord says, just come. Let me feed you. I feed the fowl of the air. They don't worry about their next meal. Come to me and I will feed you. And open your eyes and see. What are we looking at? Where is our focus? What do we choose to see in a situation? Do we choose to see the best? Do we choose to see the worst? There's evil and there's bad and there's sadness and there's bad things all around us. But God is all around us as well. We choose what we see. We choose what we focus on. We choose what we speak to and expect to change.
Right?
Yes.
So our job this morning, God says, our job, get to the table. Come and see, come and taste, but make it to the table. He has prepared a banquet, a feast. Every time we gather together, every time we go to him in prayer, every time we call on his name, we bring ourselves to the table. We bring ourselves into his presence where we can taste and see that he is good.
Amen.
In Jesus'
Amen.
Name.
Amen.
All right. Anyone have any prayer requests or testimonies this morning? Mike.
I want to thank the Lord for the six people who gave their hearts to the Lord in this place Friday night.
Yeah.
I'm rejoicing with them right now.
Amen. Amen. Yes. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Anyone else have any prayer or testimonies today? James, did you have something?
I'm good. A friend of mine, I've been talking about Orlando, and I proclaimed him to be cute.
Any prayer requests? Yeah, Tim.
Yes, we want to just praise the Lord. On the 5th of May, got a call from our son, and he was calling us to let us know that he took his wife to the hospital. They was going to just do a checkup because he ran out of baby. Well, the baby came on the 5th.
Oh.
So we had our granddaughter born that day, and we just praise the Lord that
yeah.
after 20 on the grandchildren.
Praise the Lord.
Girl.
Amen.
I am so thankful for all of the mothers, my mother. I was adopted, and I got adopted into a wonderful family. You know, it's the spirit of love that flows through people who know God is just marvelous.
Yes.
And it's a spirit not only for mothers, but for fathers, too. But it really impacts the children.
Amen. Anyone else? Prayer requests or testimonies this morning? All right, let's stand and pray and ask the Lord to join us this morning. Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning. Thank you for all the women in our lives, Lord. Our mothers, our birth mothers, our adopted mothers, our friends, all the women in our lives who taught us what love is, Lord. Thank you for your love shed abroad through the mother's heart, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Lift up all these needs before you this morning, Lord. We invite you to come join us this morning. You are welcome here, Lord. You are welcome here. We gather together this morning to worship you, Lord, to praise you, Lord, to come and taste of your goodness this morning. We ask that you manifest this morning. We ask that you minister to all those here today. We ask that you come. Come, Lord. Come in power, Lord. Bring wisdom and revelation, Lord. Let our hearts and our minds be renewed by the word today, Lord. Let us be encouraged, Lord, and lifted up through worship and praise, Lord. That as we give our sacrifice of praise, Lord, we receive the blessings of your presence, Lord. Yes, Lord, be with those members of this body who are not here today, Lord. Minister to them where they are, Lord. Draw them in from the north and the south and the east and the west, Lord. Those who have not yet heard your call, those who have tried to ignore it, Lord. We thank you for those who have been drawn here today, Lord. We thank you for those who have come today to be with you, Lord, to be with each other, Lord. Let this house be a house of prayer. Let this house be a house of praise, Lord, where you are lifted high, Lord. Help us to ask for more, Lord. Give us eyes to see and ears to hear, to follow after your Holy Spirit, Lord. Jesus, we thank you this morning for all the blessings, Lord, big and small in our lives. We thank you that when we ask and we believe, when we speak to those mountains, they are removed. That when we speak your word, it has power and authority. Thank you, Lord, that you have taught us love. Thank you that you have taught us grace. Let us be givers of all the blessings, Lord. Let it just flow through our lives. The love, the peace, the joy that you have blessed us with. Let us show others. Let us be light and salt to a weary and dying world.
Locked and loaded. I know it's going to take about 4 or 5 guys to get taken care of. Crane operator, 1 spotter, 2 on the roof, 2 on the ground. The Lord will provide. We'll coordinate Wednesday, Thursday. Crane will be here at 8 o'clock Saturday morning and hoist it out of the truck and get her on the roof.
Amen.
And the contents that we talked about are in ready to roll. Just pray for a smooth, it should only take 15, 20 minutes to sling it up there, but pray for smooth transition and for Iowa's weather to cooperate.
Yes.
Yes.
All right, well, let's speak the word this morning. Will you not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you? Yes, Lord. I am a believer, and these signs do follow me. In the name of Jesus, I cast out demons, I speak in new tongues, I lay hands on the sick and they do recover. Christ has redeemed me from the curse of the law. Therefore, I forbid any sickness the perfection to which God created it to function, and I forbid any malfunction in this body in the name of Jesus. I receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of Him, the eyes of my understanding being enlightened, and I am not conformed to this world, but am transformed by the renewing of my mind. My mind is renewed by the word of God. The Lord rebukes the devourer for my sake, and no weapon that is formed against my finances will prosper. All obstacles and hindrances to my financial prosperity are now dissolved. The Lord has pleasure in the prosperity of His servant, and Abraham's blessings are mine.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
All right. Don and John, would you please come take the offerings for me? Looking for you, John. I thought I saw you come in. John, you want to ask the blessing this morning?
Lord, we just praise you today, God, and we just are gathered here to worship you. God, we just want to thank you, Lord, for the blessings that you give us on this day of acknowledging the mothers and everything that you blessed our lives with, fathers, brothers, sisters, and children. And now, brothers and sisters, as we gather together in you, we just want to lift you up, glorify your name. Just rejoice together, Lord, and on this offering, God, that you just bless it. And bless you, God, for everything you wanted to do, and more so, just abundantly, God. We just lift up the holy name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Worship team. Even as Suzanne was praying, and y'all were praying, her, and even already in the atmosphere, Jesus, know I love you. Jesus, know I love you so. Jesus, know I love. Jesus, know I love you so.
Jesus, we love you, Lord. Jesus, we love you, Lord.
Sweet, sweet Spirit. Hallelujah.
Love you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. I want to introduce my brother, Rick Andreas. Done ministry with him in the past in the inner city. He's got so much country on him, I don't know how he can fit in the inner city. You know what you get when you cross country and rap, don't you? No, I won't go there. So he's going to bless us with his presence. And as Suzanne was singing a week or so ago, there's an army rising up. Myron, he had his acoustic here this morning, and he's going to be sitting in on the rehearsals, right, brother? And continue to do so. One other thing that Tom Stammen challenged me with Wednesday night was, do you have any 13-year-olds on your worship team? So I said I've been praying about it, and I've been announcing it. So the youth are being called from the north and the south and east and the west in our midst. If my granddaughter, who just now turned 14, would stop being 22 and be 14 again. Ray Hughes once said, teenagers need to be put in a barrel and feed them through the cork. work hall until they get past this.
Or not.
But our God's a loving God, because Jesus was a teenager too, and he lived through it.
Yes.
To complete the work that he was told to do. So, in the meantime, every knee will bow, every tongue confess, Jesus Christ, he is Lord forever. Every knee will bow, every tongue confess, Jesus Christ, he is Lord forever.
Christ is Lord forever. Every knee will bow, every tongue confess, Jesus Christ is Lord forever. Can't stop, praise his name. Can't stop, praise his name. Just can't stop, praise his name, Jesus. Can't stop, praise his name,
I just
can't stop. Praise his name,
I
just can't stop. Praise his name, Jesus.
Every knee will bow, every tongue confess, Jesus Christ is Lord forever.
Every knee will bow, every tongue confess, Christ is Lord forever. Can't stop, praise his name. Can't stop, praise his name. Just can't stop, praise his name, Jesus. Can't stop, praise his name. Can't stop, praise his name. Just can't stop, praise his name, Jesus.
The Prince of Peace, bright and morning star, Jesus Christ is Lord forever. He's the Prince of Peace, bright and morning star, Jesus Christ is Lord forever. Can't stop, praise his name, I just
can't stop, praise his name, I just can't stop. His name, Jesus. Can't stop, praise his name. Can't stop, praise his name. I just can't stop, praise his name, Jesus.
Come on, guys.
Can't stop, praise his name. Can't stop, praise his name. I just can't stop, praise his name, Jesus. Can't stop, praise his name, can't stop, praise his name, just can't stop, praise his name, Jesus. Can't stop, praise his name, can't stop, praise his name, I just can't stop, praise his name, Jesus. Can't stop, praise his name, can't stop, praise his name, I just can't stop. Praise his name, Jesus. Can't stop, praise his name,
I just
can't stop. Praise his name, I just can't stop. Praise his name, Jesus.
Verse 2, here we go.
He's the Prince of Peace, bright and morning star. Jesus Christ is Lord forever. He's the Prince of Peace, bright and morning star, Jesus Christ is all forever. Can't stop.
praise his name, I just can't stop. Praise his name, I just can't stop. Praise his name, Jesus. Can't stop.
Here we go.
Praise his name, I just can't stop. Praise his name, I just can't stop. Praise his name.
To our God. Sing hallelujah to our God. Glory hallelujah to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every praise is to our God. Every word of worship in one accord. Every praise.
My healer, yes, Lord.
times, Lord. Yes, you have. I give you all the praise. Give you all the praise. Give you all the praise. Do you love him, church? Do you love him, church? Do you love him, church? Tell him you love him, church. Come on. Hallelujah, love the Lord. Love you, Lord.
You're the mighty one, you sit on the throne. And all heaven sings your praise. We will join that song, singing one and all, to give glory to your name. Glory, 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 glory to your name. Glory, glory.
This song, Lydia Stanley. In fact, the next two songs she wrote also was married and had their first baby here a few months back. So we want to tell Lydia, Happy Mother's Day, Lydia. Thank you for the songs that the Lord birthed through you, for being faithful, and bless you on your special day this day. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Fill with
Seated with him now, by the way. He was clothed in glory, exalted high, and the train of his robe it filled the temple, and the angels circled around him and cry, "You are holy, also holy. You
to the Lord right now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. We bless your name this morning, Lord. You are a great and a mighty God, the only true and living God. We bless you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for your goodness, your mercy, your grace. Thank you for being who you are, Lord. And thank you for making us who we are in Christ. We bless you today, Lord. Help us, Lord, to recognize your blessings in all of our lives. We thank you, Lord, for blessing us with mothers who helped to direct us to you, pointed us to your goodness and your grace, and by their love showed us what the love of God is like. Praise God. We thank you, Lord, today in Jesus' name. And everybody say, praise the Lord.
Praise
Amen.
Lord.
God bless you. You may be seated.
Thank you, Lord.
In Jesus' name. Thank you, worship team. Great job as always. Appreciate the Holy Spirit's anointing on them. Amen. I really do think that the love of God is expressed so well in mothers, because mothers will stick by you. Amen.
Amen.
When everybody else is finding the reasons not to, they, for some reason, just hang in there, and as Mike would say, like hair in a biscuit, praise the Lord. So they just stay with you, praise the Lord. They don't give up, amen. And that's the way our God is. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Oh, thank the Lord, amen. Thank you, God, for all of our mothers. And mothers, we wish you a special day today. Hope that you'll get to spend it with family and loved ones, and have a day of just relaxing and enjoying, amen, the goodness of God and family. Praise the Lord. So, praise God. And because of that, I'm going to do my very best to be brief this morning so that you all can get to wherever it is you're going, whatever you're going to do. And I want to be obedient to the Lord, but at the same time, I want to get you out of here at a reasonable time, because I'm taking my wife somewhere, or I'm going somewhere with some other people with my wife. Praise the Lord. And there's a little bit of selfishness on my part, too. But anyway, hallelujah. I'll just give you a little bit of wisdom here before we move into the true wisdom of God. And that is, for mothers or anybody else, only borrow money from pessimists, because they never expect to get it back. So just keep that in mind the next time you're needing a few bucks. Praise the Lord. Amen. It's okay, lighten up. Praise God. I've never met a pessimistic banker yet, because they always want their money back. They're always expected to get it back, you know, and they do, praise God. So I want to begin in Mark chapter 9 and verse 23, and I just have some simple truths to share with you today. You know, everybody is facing challenges, and you know, the life that we have in God is one that demands faith. It can't be lived any other way. And the longer we live, the more we realize how important faith is, because we're being challenged with situations and circumstances all the time that demand that we believe in spite of what we see, in spite of what we're being told, in spite of what our circumstances might be. We have to continue to believe in something greater than the natural. And that's what the whole relationship is that we have with God, is believing Him above everything else. If you don't know the goodness of God, if you don't know the grace of God, if you don't understand the promises of God, then it's very difficult to operate in faith, because you don't know what He's going to do or what might happen. But because we have His Word, because we have these precious promises, amen, we can operate in faith. Faith is just simply believing what God says above everything else. Amen. So let's begin here in Mark chapter 9 and verse 23. Jesus said unto him, if thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believeth. Okay? If you can believe, anything's possible to you if you believe. All right? All right, 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 13. If we believe not, yet he remains faithful. He cannot deny himself. So on the one hand, whatever we believe, we can have it if we believe. But God, knowing us as well as He does, says, even when we can't believe, He remains faithful to His promises. And that's what I want to talk to you about tonight. You know, believe, I mentioned this Wednesday night, believe is made up of two old Anglo-Saxon words, two old English words, and they are be, which means to exist, or to just be alive, to live, and liaf, which means in accordance or accordance. So for us, to believe is to live in agreement or be in agreement with what God says, with who God is. That's what believing really is. It's that simple. It isn't all that complicated. It's just be in accordance with God, with what God says, in spite of everything else. And He told us that, yet, even if we don't believe, even when our belief is weak, He abides faithful.
Yes.
In Genesis, it was a faithful God who didn't give up on faithless Adam and Eve. Even after they disobeyed and rebelled against his command, God was still faithful. Then it was faithful God who found a man named Noah after the entire human race had turned away from him in faithlessness. And through one man struggling with belief, God preserved the entire human race. Then it was faithful God who chose a man named Abraham who was at times unfaithful. But through him, God created a nation. Abraham wavered in his faith, but God never wavered in his faithfulness to the promise that he made to Abraham. It was a faithful God who called a fearful man named Moses to bring his people out of bondage and slavery. Amen. It was a faithful God who raised up Joshua after the faithless generation he led refused to enter into the promised land. His people took the land. They defeated enemies. They were successful because God fought for them, even when they fought against God's purpose through disobedience and unbelief. It was a faithful God who raised up judges to deliver Israel as they were sinning against him and did what was right in their own eyes. It was a faithful God who chose a shepherd boy named David who didn't operate in faith a lot of times, multiple times. And yet God was faithful to David. So much so that his promise that out of David's seed would come the Messiah. And humanly speaking, Jesus was that child, that son, that heir. And he appears to rescue his people from their sins. Faithfully, Jesus led the perfect life that we couldn't live. Faithfully, he went to the cross and died the death that we should have. Faithfully, God raised him from the dead and defeated sin and death and gave life to everyone who would believe.
Exactly.
Our faith may fail, but God's faithfulness will never fail. Praise the Lord. So let's look at this, Exodus chapter 14 and verse 14. The Lord shall fight for you, and ye shall hold your peace. In other words, the Lord will fight, you just relax.
Yes.
Let him do the fighting.
Amen.
See, the goal of grace isn't to take away your fears, but to leverage those fears to create greater faith. Praise the Lord. Grace leads you past your fears and reassures you of God's presence. God knows that all the uncertainties we're dealing with, but they are not uncertainties to God. Our maybes aren't maybes to God. Praise the Lord. 1 Samuel chapter 14 and verse 6. Jonathan said to the young man that bare his armor, you may know the story surrounding this. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail for the simple reason that I want to be brief. But there's a great battle. There's been battles. The Philistines are defeating Saul's armies, and Jonathan, Saul's son, is with his armor bearer. And Jonathan said to the young man that bare his armor, come, let us go over unto the garrison of these uncircumcised, the enemy, and it may be that the Lord will work for us, for there's no restraint to the Lord to save by many or by few. So he says, maybe, let's go over into the garrison of these uncircumcised. It may be that the Lord will work for us, because there's no lack with God. There's no inability for on God's behalf to do anything that he wants to do. Amen? So maybe the Lord will act on our behalf. Maybe? Maybe? Praise the Lord. Sounds like spiritual schizophrenia. You know, on the one hand, nothing can hinder our God. Maybe the Lord will act. How many of you ever lived there? You know, are there? Praise the Lord. Maybe. Real faith. Believing always feels that way. I know God is able to do anything. God is able to do everything. I know God can, and I'm pretty sure that he will. but I can't be completely sure. That's where faith, that's where believing comes in. We live in agreement with God. We exist in agreement with God. We believe, even with our maybes. Faith isn't the absence of uncertainties. Faith isn't the absence of ambiguity. Faith is believing God's promises are bigger than our maybes.
Yeah. Yes.
Praise the Lord. God knows all of the uncertainties we're dealing with. I said a moment ago, but those are not uncertainties to God, only to us. Because our maybes are not maybes from God's perspective. They're certainties. They're the truth. They're the reality. They're His Word.
Yes.
Galatians chapter 2 and verse 20. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave Himself for me. Which is one reason why believers, even though we have our maybes, can be successful in every situation, overcome every consequence and circumstance that comes against us, because it's the faith of Jesus. We're believing in Him,
yes.
His perfect faith, because He's faithful even when we're faithless.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Matthew chapter 14, verses 24 through 29. I just want to give you a few just simple little things here that kind of can help us. You know, sometimes we talk about faith and you hear messages and so on and so forth about faith, but it gets so deep that you just kind of blows your mind. Like, I mean, can't we simplify this somehow? I mean, can't we just do it? I mean, can't we just believe? Just believe what God says. Even when my faith wavers, I can still believe in what God has said. Amen. So the ship was now in the midst of the sea. Another story we've read many times from the Bible about Peter and his the other disciples in a boat. Jesus had sent them across the lake. He waits, and they get in the midst of this big storm on their way to the other side, right? But the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went unto them, walking on the sea. And when the disciples saw Him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, "It's a spirit." And they cried out for fear. But straightway Jesus spake unto them, saying, "Be of good cheer, it's I. Be not afraid." And Peter answered Him and said, "Lord, if it be Thou, bid me come unto Thee on the water." And He said, "Come." And when Peter was come down out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. So believing, or faith, I'm using these as just synonyms, as just, you know, meaning the same thing. Amen. It starts with Peter hearing a word from Jesus. But he's still in the boat. He got a word from God, and he hadn't done anything about it yet. He's still sitting in the boat. Next, he speaks it. It's activating his faith or belief. You know how we talk about speak the word. Speak to the situation. Speak to the storm. Speak to the devil. Speak to the lies. Speak to the things that come against us, because we have authority. That's what God gave us. When we were born again, we were put back in the position that Adam and Eve were in originally, which was a place of authority on this earth.
Right.
Have dominion. So it's not enough just to hear something from God or to read a promise from God. At some point, you've got to say something about it.
Right.
You have to activate that word. Amen? And that's what Peter did. If it's you, tell me to come. He's speaking, right? He's vocalizing. It's an expression of faith or belief. He's committing verbally to what he heard. But he's still in the boat. Amen? Jesus says, "Come." And then Peter steps out of the boat and transcends the law of buoyancy. In other words, he don't sink. He's walking on the water to Jesus. So you hear the word, you speak the word, and then you do the word. Praise the Lord. You won't do the word if you don't know the word. And if you don't know the word, you can't declare the word. But if you hear it and if you declare it, now action will take place. You'll begin to believe. You'll begin to step out in faith and start doing things you didn't think you could do, believing for things that God has promised you, and defying the maybes and declaring God's word to be true. Amen? Amen. But let's look at verse 30. Because here's the ringer. When he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid and began to sink. And he cried out to the Lord, "Save me." Peter sees and sinks. Praise the Lord. He looks, he sees, and he sinks. Maybe just took over. The maybe just become greater than the promise. Because he sees all these things telling him something contrary to what he had heard from the Lord. So let's look at this. I want to show you kind of an analogy here. In 1 Kings chapter 18, and let's read verses 41 through 43. 1 Kings 18, 41 through 43. Elijah said unto Ahab, "Get thee up, eat and drink, for there's a sound of abundance of rain." So Ahab went up to eat and to drink, and Elijah went up to the top of Carmel, and he cast himself down upon the earth and put his face between his knees. And he said to his servant, "Go up now, look toward the sea." And he went up and looked and said, "There's nothing." And he said, "Go again seven times." So while Ahab went back down the mountain to eat and drink, Elijah goes the other direction. He goes back up to the top of Mount Carmel. He bends down, puts his head between his knees, and he didn't kiss his butt behind goodbye. He was praying. Yes. Praise the Lord. Because I know that thought came to me the first time I read that. You know, what they used to tell us in school when I was a kid, and they, you know, when a nuclear attack comes, you put your head down between your knees like that was going to make a difference. You just wouldn't see the blast, I guess. But and everybody used to say, yeah, that was just so you could kiss yourself goodbye. Praise the Lord. But that's not what he's doing. He put his face between his knees and begins to pray. Amen. Amen. And so right away, he sends his servant to look toward the sea and to check and see if the rain has started yet. Because he's declared there's rain's coming, right? Servant comes back and he says, "Nothing. Nothing going on. There's not a cloud in the sky. Clear blue." Now, the issue here is that God himself had commanded Elijah to speak and declare that the three-year drought was going to end. So he had a word from the Lord. He knew what he was supposed to do, and he did it. And yet nothing's happening. Amen? Not only that, but Elijah had heard the sound with his own ears of the rain, of the storm. He heard the rumbling. He said, "I hear the sound of abundance of rain." So he had a word from the Lord. And he actually felt in himself the reality of that word. Amen. But there's nothing there. Seeing manifestation begins when you hear God's voice. If you know what the word is, it'll resonate in you. It'll tell you, you know, the doctor's told you this, but by my stripes you're healed. You hear, you feel that, you sense that in your spirit. Amen. And it's his voice speaking to you. He's speaking to your spirit. It's not an audible voice necessarily, and usually it isn't. It's just a strong impression. It's just an inner sense that God's going to do what he said he would do. So you go to the top of your mountain. You go to that thing that's confronting you, and you climb that mountain, and you look to the sea for your payoff. And a lot of times, you see absolutely nothing. And most of the time, nobody around you sees anything either. Nothing there. No confirmation, no breakthrough. And that's enough to make most people doubt. It's enough to make most people start saying, maybe God's not going to do it this time. I know he can, but maybe not. But I want you to notice something about Elijah. Elijah never actually looked for the clouds. In fact, he made a point not to look by putting his face between his knees. He didn't look at anything. He's bowed down, his face covered, and that's not a coincidence. It's actually strategic. And it illustrates fundamental belief. When what you see around you doesn't match with what God's spoken to you, you have to hold on to what you heard, not what you're seeing. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 7. Believe me, if you haven't been faced with this, you will. Yes. Where everything you're seeing is denying what God has said. You're going to have to learn to hang on to what you heard instead of what you're seeing and what everybody else is declaring. That's called belief. That's living in agreement with God. For we walk by faith, not by sight. That's just not an add-on. That's not a cliche. That's us, if we're going to be successful. Praise the Lord. Amen. All right, Mark 9:23 again. Jesus said unto him, if thou canst believe, everything's possible. Yes. Amen? If you believe. If you'll stay in agreement with God. If you'll be in accordance with what he says. 2 Timothy 2:13 again, please. If we believe not, yet he abideth faithful. He cannot deny himself. In other words, no maybes. No ifs, ands, or buts. No maybes. Who are you going to believe? God or your lying eyes? Praise the Lord. Amen? He's faithful. Even when we're unfaithful. He's true to his word. We just need to stay in agreement with it. Quit looking, quit believing what you're seeing, and believe what you heard, and it shall come to pass because you believe. Give the Lord a hand clap. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Okay, let's, if I could get Don and Juan, praise the Lord, to come and pass out the elements here for the communion. We're going to take communion here. Praise the Lord. And Mike, if you will, I'd like you to go to 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 26 as they're passing out the 1 Corinthians 11 and verse 26. Praise the Lord, everybody. Ladies, mothers, again, I hope you have a blessed day today and get to enjoy some quiet time and relax and let somebody wait on you for a little while. If they don't, then just let it be. Don't let it, just let it go. Don't do it. If you don't do it long enough, somebody will. Praise the Lord. Amen. Of course, if they don't, that means you've got a lot more work to do later, but what the heck. Praise the Lord. Okay, I want to just point out a couple of things here before we actually partake of the bread and the wine. So, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he comes. So this is what we're doing whenever we take communion. We're showing the Lord's death until he returns. And what about the Lord's death are we showing? And who are we showing it to? Colossians chapter 2, verses 13 through 15. Colossians 2, 13 through 15. And you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which is the law, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross. And having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. The tool that the devil always used was the law in order to condemn. He had a legal right to do it, and that's what he always did. Well, once Jesus fulfilled the law, the enemy was stripped of his power, of his weapon against us. That's why there's no more condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, and that's what he's telling us. That's what we're showing. So when we remember Jesus' death, we're telling the principalities, the powers, that they have been disarmed because he has triumphed over them. We're slapping the devil in the face this morning and telling him, I don't care what attack you bring against me, it cannot stand. You've already been defeated. And this is the evidence. This is us showing you, we know who we are. We know what we have received. We know what our inheritance is. And we're declaring that to you until Jesus comes himself. In the meantime, we are the body of Christ declaring that what his death, burial, and resurrection has meant, not only to us, but to the enemies of the cross. Praise the Lord. Every principality, every power, every evil, every wickedness in high places, amen, the devil that comes to steal, kill, and to destroy is defeated. Yes. And that's what we're celebrating this morning. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. When we release our faith in the finished, complete, and perfect work of Jesus at the cross, every knee has to bow, every tongue has to confess that Jesus is Lord. Cancer has to bow its knee. Amen. Diabetes has to bow its knee. Amen. Poverty has to bow its knee. Binding broken families, and they have to bow their knee. Every spiritual wicked evil in this world, in the principalities and powers of the air, has to bow its knee to Christ and to those who have been given authority in his mighty name. Praise the Lord. And that's what we're celebrating this morning. That's what we're declaring, amen, as we stand in the person of Christ, in the body of Jesus Christ, and we take his blood and his body. We're saying we're ingesting the victory one more time. Hallelujah. And we're declaring that you are defeated, amen, and no weapon formed against us can prosper, and every tongue that rises in judgment against us, we condemn. This is the heritage of the children of God, amen. Praise the Lord. So if we can, let's go back to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And verses 24 through 26. If you can't get them all up there, 24 and 25 is good. We can go to 26 after. But when he had given thanks, he broke the bread and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." After the same manner, also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me." For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he comes. Praise the Lord. Give the Lord a hand clap one more time. Praise the Lord. Amen. We just showed the devil something. Praise the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Get you some of that. Praise the Lord. Amen. God bless you all. Dismissed in Jesus' name. Have a great day. Hope we'll see you back here Wednesday, if not Sunday. God bless you in the meantime.